Penguin Audio presents The Secret History of the American Empire by John Perkins. Read by Jonathan Davis, with a special introduction read by the author.
Hi, this is John Perkins. This book takes up where Confessions of an Economic Hitman left off. Back when I finished writing that book in 2004, I had no idea whether anyone would want to read about my life as an economic hitman, EHM. I chose to describe events that I needed to confess. Subsequently, traveling across the U.S. and to other countries, lecturing, fielding questions, and talking with men and women who are concerned about the future, I have come to understand that people everywhere desire to know what is really going on in the world today. We all want to be able to read between the lines of the news reports and hear the truths that are glossed over by the self-serving pronouncements of the individuals who control our businesses, governments, and media. Collectively, the corporatocracy. As I explained in Confessions, I tried to write that book several times. I approached other EHMs and Jackals, the CIA-sponsored mercenaries who step in to influence, cajole, bribe, and sometimes assassinate, and asked them to include their stories. Word quickly spread. I myself was bribed and threatened. I stopped writing. After 9/11, when I made the commitment to move forward, I decided that this time I would tell no one until the manuscript was published. At that point, it became an insurance policy. The Jackals knew that if anything unusual happened to me, sales of the book would skyrocket. Writing Confessions without assistance from others with similar experiences might have been difficult, but it was my safest route. Since its publication, people have stepped out from the shadows. EHMs, Jackals, reporters, Peace Corps volunteers, corporate executives and World Bank, International Monetary Fund, and government officials have come to me with their own confessions. The stories they share on the following CDs expose the facts behind the events that are shaping the world our children will inherit. They underscore the inevitable conclusion. We must act. We must change. I want to emphasize that you will not find gloom and doom on these CDs. I'm optimistic. I know that, although serious, our problems are man-made. We are not threatened by a giant meteor. The fire of the sun has not been extinguished. Because we created these problems, we can solve them. By exploring the dark recesses of our past, we can develop a light for examining and changing the future. When you finish listening to this audio version of The Secret History of the American Empire, you too will, I believe, feel absolutely confident that we will do the right thing. You will have identified a plan of action. Together, we will utilize the resources Providence has provided to establish human societies that reflect our highest ideals. One evening, a few months into my book tour for Confessions, I found myself lecturing in a Washington, D.C. bookstore. The woman introducing me had mentioned earlier that she expected a number of World Bank staffers to attend. Created at Bretton Woods in my home state of New Hampshire in 1944, the bank was charged with reconstructing countries devastated by the war. Its mission soon became synonymous with proving that the capitalist system was superior to that of the Soviet Union. To further this role, its employees cultivated cozy relationships with capitalism's main proponents, multinational corporations. This opened the door for me and other EHMs to mount a multi-trillion-dollar scam. We channeled funds from the bank and its sister organizations into schemes that appeared to serve the poor while primarily benefiting a few wealthy people. Under the most common of these, we would identify a developing country that possessed resources our corporations coveted, such as oil, arrange a huge loan for that country, and then direct most of the money to our own engineering and construction companies, and a few collaborators in the developing country. Infrastructure projects, such as power plants, airports, and industrial parks, sprang up. However, they seldom help the poor, who are not connected to electrical grids, never used airports, and lack the skills required for employment in industrial parks. At some point, we EHMs returned to the indebted country and demanded our pound of flesh. Cheap oil, votes on critical United Nations issues, or troops to support ours someplace in the world, like Iraq. In my talks, I often find it necessary to remind audiences of a point that seems obvious to me, but is misunderstood by so many, that the World Bank is not really a World Bank at all. It is, rather, a U.S. bank. Ditto its closest sibling, the IMF. Of the 24 directors on their boards, 8 represent individual countries: the United States, Japan, Germany, France, the United Kingdom, Saudi Arabia, China, and Russia. The rest of the 184 member countries share the other 16 directors. The United States controls nearly 17% of the vote in the IMF and 16% in the World Bank. Japan is second with about 6% in the IMF and 8% in the bank, followed by Germany, the United Kingdom, and France, each with around 5%. The United States holds veto power over major decisions, and the President of the United States appoints the World Bank president. When my formal talk was finished, I was escorted to a table to sign books. The line snaked through the rows of bookcases. It would be another long evening. What I had not expected were the number of men and women in business attire who handed me cards indicating that they held high positions in foreign embassies and the World Bank. There were several ambassadors from other countries. A couple of these asked me to sign books for their presidents as well as for themselves. The last people in line were 4 men. 2 wore business suits and ties, and 2 who were much younger were dressed in blue jeans and polo shirts. The older men handed me their World Bank business cards. One of the younger men spoke up. "Our fathers gave us permission to tell you this," he said. "We've watched them go off to work every morning at the bank, dressed," he pointed at them, "like this. But when protesters congregate here in Washington to demonstrate against the bank, our fathers join them. We watch them go incognito, wearing old clothes, baseball caps, and sunglasses to support those people because they believe they, and you, are right." Both of the older men shook my hand vigorously. "We need more whistleblowers like you," one of them said. "Write another book," the other added. "Include more of the details you presented tonight about what happened to the countries you worked in, all the damage done by people like us in the name of progress. Expose this empire. Spell out the truth behind places like Indonesia, where the statistics look so good and the realities so bad. And also give us hope. Offer our sons alternatives. Map out a way for them to do a better job." I promised him I would write such a book. Before we get into the main text of that book, I would like to examine a word he used: empire. It has been bandied about in the press and classrooms and at local pubs for the last few years. But what exactly is an empire? Does America, with its magnificent constitution, its Bill of Rights, its advocacy of democracy, really deserve such a label, one that brings to mind a long history of brutal and self-serving rule? Empire, nation-state that dominates other nation-states and exhibits one or more of the following characteristics. 1, exploits resources from the lands it dominates. 2, consumes large quantities of resources, amounts that are disproportionate to the size of its population relative to those of other nations. 3, maintains a large military that enforces its policies when more subtle measures fail. 4, spreads its language, literature, art, and various aspects of its culture throughout its sphere of influence. 5, taxes not just its own citizens, but also people in other countries. And 6, imposes its own currency on the lands under its control. This definition of empire was formulated in meetings I held with students at a number of universities during my book tour in 2005 and 2006. Almost without exception, the students arrived at the following conclusion. The United States exhibits all the characteristics of a global empire. Addressing each of the above points, points 1 and 2, the United States represents...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.